Okay, students, this is experiment 2, percent copper in an unknown compound. In this activity, we're going to learn one of several techniques that there are for composition analysis. Let's say that you are given a copper-containing compound, specifically a compound that contains copper 2 ions. Compounds that contain the copper 2 ions are typically blue, such as this example you're seeing here on this picture. Our objective is to identify the unknown compound on the basis of its mass percent of copper. We're going to achieve this by using chemical analysis. Now, it may be that at the time you're watching this video, we still haven't discussed chemical reactions and chemical equations in class. So the following symbols might look a little foreign to you, although you should be familiar with them from your introductory chemistry class. We're going to start with a copper 2 containing compound by dissolving it in water. So it's going to be aqueous. The solution will have a blue color. We're going to combine it with a solution of sodium hydroxide. And the result of that is going to be the production of a copper 2 hydroxide compound. This should be solid. In other words, it will precipitate and it will still have a blue color, although typically a darker blue than the compound that you started with. In the next step, oh, by the way, we say here on balance because since we don't know what X is, we can't fully balance this equation. In the next step, we're going to take that copper 2 hydroxide that we produced and we're going to heat it to convert it into a very stable compound, which is copper 2 oxide that has a, you know, kind of like a dark ash, kind of black kind of color. And because of the heat, the water will be eventually eliminated, evaporated. So what's going to happen here is that we are going to collect that copper 2 oxide product, and by measuring its mass, we'll be able to calculate how much copper is in it and therefore conclude how much copper was in our original unknown compound sample. A couple of things about chemical analysis. First of all, it's important to allow atoms to connect with each other so they can form the compounds that we need. We achieve this in this case typically by just doing good mixing of our materials. Sometimes chemical reactions require us to provide energy. In this case, we're going to provide it in the form of heat. We also have to remember to observe safety guidelines. In this case, one of them is to avoid spattering because that will cause us to lose product, or we could actually have some stuff kind of like jump up on our skin and cause burns. Speaking of which, also remember to be careful in the handling of hot objects. In this activity, you're going to be using the analytical balance. You should have watched the video that was in our Canvas laboratory page. And just to review here, remember that when you make a measurement, you need to keep the sliding windows closed during the measurement. Otherwise, drafts, air currents can affect your measurement and make the digital display unstable. Never place chemicals directly on the plate. Always use some form of container to put your chemicals into it. If you spill anything, please clean your spills immediately. Don't walk off thinking, oh, I'll come back and clean it later, because A, you probably forget. B, some other student might be wanting to use the balance. C, if too much time passes, you could start getting some corrosion of the metal plate. And an important thing is that these instruments are calibrated, not only as an instrument, but also even for the position they are on the table in the balance room. So once you start using a balance for making measurements during an experiment, you should continue using the same balance for all of the measurements done during that experiment, for every trial in that experiment. Don't forget that whenever you're going to measure something, you're going to start at zero, and that's what this red button here is for. That is your zero button. That's how you bring the display down to zero so you can take accurate measurements. Speaking of which, there are two ways that you can measure the mass of your sample. One of them is what's called to tear the container. You place the empty container on the balance, and then you zero it. That way, when you add your sample, you are actually recording the mass of the sample directly. This is a technique that works if once you do this measurement, you're not going to have to do subsequent measurements of that same sample. Another technique is to weight the container before and after adding your sample. So the difference between the filled versus the empty container is the mass of your sample. This technique is preferable when you're going to be doing several measurements of your sample after you have carried out several steps of procedures. That way you know what the base mass was of the container and you can track the changes in the mass of your sample. As far as the procedures go, please obtain the handout from your Canvas assignment page. Watch the procedures video where I'm going to walk you through what you would do in this lab. Make sure you download your own known data file. This will contain the information you need to complete your data analysis and your lab report. Then please watch the data analysis video where I'm going to walk you through an example of analyzing a set of data. Complete your lab report and then make sure you submit your assignment by the due date. Okay, that is it for now. And so let's go ahead and watch the procedures video. Thank you.